Ya no sé hace rato a qué hora se conectaron los de Irapuato, pero habíamos presentado al papá del siguiente presentador y les platicaba que una cosa chistosa que pasó es que cuando estaba arreglando que viniera el papá, como los dos se apellidan igual, yo me equivoqué y le dije que lo iba a traer de Houston, pero escribí Boston. O sea, entonces ya me dice, oye, yo creo que al que quieres invitar es a mi hijo, porque pues había escrito que el MIT está en Boston. Y entonces le dije, ah, también lo quiero invitar. Esa es la génesis. Y claro, como iba a estar aquí la señora Carol con su esposo, pues a su hijo, pues contentos todo el mundo de mi familia. Acá está Carol en la esquina, ¿sí? La esposa del doctor Lienhard y la mamá del doctor Lienhard, ¿sí? Y entonces así fue como se fue armando. O sea, claro que, oye, que me dicen del MIT, lo invito luego, ¿no? O sea, no lo dudamos. Y aquí nuestros muchachos, esta es una historia para los que no son de aquí de la facultad, que son nuestros visitantes. Aquí podemos presumir que tenemos un programa de intercambio con el MIT. Nuestros chavos fueron el año pasado a Boston, fueron en septiembre. Septiembre fueron. ¿Quiénes de aquí fueron a Boston? Ahí, Adam allá atrás. Fueron de la gente, fueron más, claro, pero fue de la gente que fueron al MIT. Y los chavos del MIT vinieron en marzo. Entonces, ahorita estamos haciendo arreglos a través del doctor Lienhard para que el programa de intercambio continúe. Eso es nada más de presumirles, ahora sí, a los de afuera, porque tener un programa de intercambio con el MIT, pues sencillamente ir a los laboratorios. Los muchachos me platicaban que los laboratorios, yo he estado allá y yo sé de lo que me estaban hablando, están impresionantes. La herramienta por donde quiera, aquí que andamos sufriendo por herramienta, ya hasta te atropiezas tanta equipo y herramienta que hay. Entonces, el papá de John, ¿sí? Pues fue la unión para que John estuviera aquí. Él es una persona mucho, muy ocupada. Ya ni tiempo tiene de dar clases, ya no da clases. Él dirige es el director de un instituto que trabaja mucho con desalination. I'm having troubles to say desalination in Spanish, believe me. Y entonces, si ustedes van al currículum que se los mandamos por ahí en la página, van a ver que los nombres son medio árabes, los nombres de donde es el jefe del instituto y todo eso, porque él ha hecho muchos arreglos con Saudi Arabia, con Kuwait, con Qatar, y se la pasa haciendo con el prestigio del MIT. Claro que los árabes le avientan el dinero para que trabaje en desalination. Entonces, incluso aquí estamos haciendo algún arreglo para que de alguna manera nos anclemos a través de John con el MIT. Y el hecho de que ustedes estén aquí, acérquense, ahorita chavos que vinieron a platicar con los conferencistas, acérquense, aprovechen eso. Yo creo que todos los que ya estamos viejos tenemos nuestras historias de, cuando yo me senté a platicar con fulanito, ¿no? La mía, siempre la eterna favorita mía es, el inventor del jabón Dove fue mi asesor. Porque un día vencí el miedo, ¿sí?, de hablar inglés, y él estaba en la vieja cafetería. Yo creo que José Luis, ustedes conocieron las viejas instalaciones de la FIME. Estábamos en la cafetería y yo, así joven como ustedes, también tuve cabello. También fue joven y bello. A Zamora éramos jóvenes y bellos. Más jóvenes que bellos. Y vencí el miedo de acercármele a este profesor extranjero que había sido invitado a la facultad en una cafetería a decirle, that's the wall, that's the chair, el inglés, que no había Harmon Hall, ¿verdad? No había Harmon Hall. Entonces, ustedes acérquense al doctor Shuba. Acá está el doctor Enrico Shuba, right here. Acá está el doctor Greg Kowalski, ¿sí? De aquí, de nuestras grandes luminarias del país, tenemos al doctor José Luis Fernández Sayas, ¿sí?, el director del Instituto de Investigaciones Eléctricas. Aquí tenemos al doctor Eduardo Ramos, ¿sí?, nivel 3 del SNI, del Instituto de Energías Renovables de Temisco, ¿sí? Entonces, ahorita en los breaks, acérquense. Ellos incluso vienen con el gusto de acercarse a ustedes. Esa es parte de aquí. Entonces, hagan eso, muchachos. Entonces, acérquense también a John. Siempre andan a la busca de esclavos.
Always looking for slaves.
Sí. Y pues no necesita más introducción, él trabaja en el MIT. Su papá es John Lienhard. Digo, qué bárbaro, ¿no? Qué envidia, ¿sí? Ojalá que mi hijo que está por ahí se fije, ¿verdad? Que, que, que puede llegar también. Sí. Muy bien. The floor is yours. Go for it. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Abel. And thank you all for being here today. It's my great pleasure to be here at Guanajuato to speak to you a bit about some of the things we've been doing on water supply and desalination. I'm going to talk about desalination and the broader question of water security, but I'm going to frame this in terms of the things that mechanical engineers bring to this discussion. I hope to convince you by the time I'm done that mechanical engineering has an important and very central role to the provision of adequate supplies of safe, clean water to the world. And you'll see what I mean as I go along. The chart that is up behind me, of course, it's a chart of the world. And what is illustrated here in red are areas in which we are using, which human beings are using 100% of the water they obtain renewably. A renewable source of fresh water is simply precipitation, rain or snowfall over land. That's how we get fresh water renewably, and that's the only process by which we get fresh water renewably. Seawater is vaporized by the sun. Energy of the sun condenses, becomes rainfall, and that's how we have a water cycle that gives us fresh water. You can take water from rivers, you know, it's come down as rain, but if you take water from a lake and drain the lake, you simply used up stored fresh water. That's not renewable. If you pump out an aquifer under the ground, the water table drops and doesn't replenish, you have used water non-renewably. Essentially, you're taking fossil water. And so the interest is in finding a supply of water that can meet the needs of our growing population. You'll see that the places where 100% of the renewable water is being taken cover the entire world. They cover rich countries, they cover poor countries, they cover places that we think of as being very dry and places that we think of as being very wet. It really depends on how many people are taking the available water and for what purpose. It also shows you that the solution to this problem is different in every case, causes and the solution. You can have a very populous, rich country in the desert, which will get its water through one process, desalination perhaps, using plentiful oil supplies. You can have another place in the world where the population is large, but you don't have the wealthy economy to meet the need. Different approach has to be taken. So as we think about water, we're always thinking about a problem that is regional and a problem that occurs in some given context. The impact of our quest to get water cannot be understated. This was the Aral Sea in Central Asia. This is 68,000 square kilometers, the world's fourth largest freshwater lake. If you think in terms of North America, it's a volume equivalent to Lake Erie plus Lake Ontario. It's that big. There's cities along here. There's a fishing industry, an economy based on the existence of this lake. The lake is fed by two rivers, which come from farther north. And those rivers were diverted for the production of crops in Uzbekistan, with the result that less water entered the lake and it dried up. And this happened over really not such a long period of time. This is an example of the kind of impact that we have all over the world every day at similar scales in many places. If you go to Google, you'll quickly find photographs of the ships that used to sail this lake sitting in the dust, the fishing vessels. Right? The cities along here, of course, wiped out. The atmosphere is much warmer now. There are dust storms. It's a complete transformation. And this is one example among many. Most of the water that we use in the world is used for growing food. 70% is for irrigation. Irrigation is not always a very efficient process. In fact, it's challenging for us to find efficient ways to irrigate at large scale. But still, agriculture occurs at an enormous scale. It is arguably the single greatest environmental effect that we've had on the planet. We use 40% of the Earth's ice-free land to grow food, for example. So the impact is enormous, and it's part of the question. apart from what I've shown you on groundwater, on surface water, there's also an impact on groundwater because much of the irrigation water is pumped up from underground. And so these are some charts from the United States. This is the central U.S., the so-called Ogallala Aquifer, Texas, all the way up to South Dakota. This is in California in the San Joaquin Valley, where they grow a lot of fruits and vegetables in the U.S. This shows the change in groundwater from about 1950 to 2007. And you can see here regions in the central U.S. where the groundwater table has dropped by 50 meters. It's down 50 meters as a result of extraction. If you go to the San Joaquin Valley, there are regions where it's dropped by more than 120 meters. It means the water's got to be pumped up for much greater depth at much greater energy cost. It also has had effects on the surface. In parts of the San Joaquin Valley, because you've taken the water out, the ground has settled, and there are areas where the surface has dropped more than 15 meters as a result of groundwater extraction. And so the impact is quite large. But this is just two examples, and this has been found by satellite measurements over the entire world. And our quest for water, our demand for water, are having effects that we are scarcely even able to quantify. But at the same time, we live on a planet that's covered with water. No shortage of water in the world. It just happens to be salty. And so one of the important questions, challenges, and opportunities for us is whether we can find ways to convert salty water into water we can use for drinking and for irrigation, certainly at least for the cities along the coast and other places. There's a lot of activity around this and a lot of growth. This question of whether we can take the salt out in a way that is economical, energy efficient, and environmentally sound is my main concern, and it's what I'll focus on in this talk. I want to start by talking a bit about osmosis and reverse osmosis, which are the most widely used processes by which we desalinate water. And so I want to remind you a bit of what you probably studied in chemistry years ago. If you have salty water on one side of a membrane and pure water on the other side of a membrane, the membrane will allow water to pass, but not salt. Then there is a natural tendency for pure water to flow from the pure side into the salty side. It's essentially trying to reach equilibrium, right, to get the same concentrations, the same Gibbs energy on both sides of the membrane. And you may have done or seen an experiment where you put a little bit of membrane onto a tulip bulb and put it in a beaker full of salt water, and you see a column of fresh water rise above as a result of what's called the osmotic pressure. And so the osmotic pressure measures the tendency for water to flow from the pure side to the salty side. Osmotic pressure rises essentially in a straight line with the salinity or the concentration of salts in the salty water, tells us how the process behaves. In reverse osmosis, we make the water flow the other way. We reverse it. And we reverse it by applying a hydraulic pressure that is greater than the osmotic pressure. If this were seawater, the hydraulic pressure would need to be more than about 28 bar, 28 atmospheres. And then you could make the water flow the opposite way. And in fact, this process is widely used. It's commercially out there. With millions of cubic meters of water being produced this way every day. And I'll tell you more about this process as we go forward. This is an example of reverse osmosis and inverse osmosis process, in this case being implemented in Copiapó in the Atacama Desert in Chile. This is a very dry part of the world. In this desert, average rainfall is about 3 millimeters. Year. There are parts of this desert where precipitation has never been recorded. It's that dry. They get their water from the Andes. Snow melts in the mountains. They're about 100 kilometers away. It comes down in rivers, and that's what allows them to have cities and settlements there. In Copiapó, there is a river, the Rio Copiapó, that runs through the middle of the city, or that used to run through the middle of the city. That water was diverted for mining. A lot of mining in that desert, mostly copper, that's being exported to China. And there's also agriculture there. It turns out that if you irrigate in the desert, you can grow marvelous crops. You can grow big grapes, great big grapes. They get exported to Japan. These Kopiapo grapes in Japan will sell for about $10 a piece. So it's a very good market. But the result of this has been that the water that used to flow through the Kopiapo River no longer flows. The river has been dry for 15 years. And so Kopiapo is getting its water supply by groundwater, pumping water up. But the water is slightly salty. It's about 3,000 parts per million of dissolved salts. It's what we would call brackish water. And the brackish water has to be desalinated before it can be used for drinking and other purposes. And they do that with this plant that you see here. In this plant, the water comes in. There's some pretreatment to filter it. And then eventually it enters these high-pressure pumps. The pumps take it to about 9 bar pressure, 9 atmospheres. And then it enters these pressure vessels. It circulates through a lower train of vessels and then comes back through an upper train. And in each of these vessels, there is a membrane, or a set of membranes. The membranes are wound into spiral sheets inside these tubes. I'll show you the flow path in a minute. These modules, this one's about a meter long, about 20 centimeters in diameter. And there are a series of maybe 6 or 7 of them in a row inside the pressure vessel. And so the pressurized water enters the vessel here. Water is taken out through a center tube. The brine that's created is discarded. It's actually used for mining. And the fresh water that leaves is the supply for part of Kopiapo. This plant produces about 147 liters per second of water, about, I believe, 8,000 cubic meters in a day. So it's a significant amount of water that's being generated. It's very important to the community. I want to talk next about energy consumption and desalination. The first thing you'll hear when somebody talks about desalination is, oh, desalination, it uses a lot of energy. And I'd like to talk about how much energy it uses, why it uses that much, and whether or not that's a lot. Because a lot is always a comparison, and you always need to compare when you say a lot. So next slide. I come at this from a thermodynamics perspective, thermal science perspective. And as a result, I put a control volume around things whenever I think about them. And any of you who are mechanical engineers probably start the same way. So here's a desalination system inside this box. Entering the box is seawater. Leaving the box is some fresh water that we took, and then the rest of the water and all of the salts, concentrated brine, we would call it. You might take about half of the water as fresh water, and the other half leaves with the brine. So the brine is twice as salty as the seawater that came in. But to make this separation happen, you need to provide energy. You saw it in the desalination plant. It was the electrical energy going into the pumps. Thermodynamically, we call that work. And so it's the electrical work being done by electricity turning the windings of the pump. So work is done to make the separation happen. And it's a fairly straightforward calculation. You use the first law, you use the second law, and you can calculate what that work is by assuming that the system is reversible. There are no losses. It's an ideal system. So the pumps are perfect. All the separations are perfect. There's no friction, etc. And if you do that calculation, you find the lowest amount, the least work that's required. It depends on thermodynamic property called Gibbs energy, H minus TS, enthalpy minus temperature times entropy, for the streams leaving relative to the stream entering. And so you've basically raised the Gibbs energy of the system by providing this work. If you calculate this number for seawater, taking 50% of the water, you'll find that the least amount of work is about 1 kilowatt hour of electricity per 1,000 liters of water produced. So this is the best you're ever going to do, 1 kilowatt hour of electricity to make a cubic meter of water. For real plants, you don't do that well because you do have losses in the system. And for the state-of-the-art reverse osmosis plants today, the energy requirement is between 2 and 4 kilowatt hours of electricity per cubic meter. The reason for this is that the system's not reversible. You have entropy generated in the system. I'll talk more about that later. But these losses raise the energy requirement above the least work. These benchmarks, knowing what the thermodynamic limit is very important for a number of reasons. Tells you how good your process is relative to what it can be, and it allows you to assess claims that people make. There's a lot of research these days around novel materials for desalination. A lot of things get published by press release, and a lot of people who are hoping to make a great deal of money by inventing something new. And so we see a number of things that come out. This was a paper published a couple of years ago. I took out the author's names. But they claimed that their new membrane would reduce the energy by 3 orders of magnitude from reverse osmosis, by a factor of 1,000. I've already shown you that today's reverse osmosis plants are within a factor of 2 to 4 of the reversible limit. It's impossible to reduce the energy by a factor of 1,000. It would violate the laws of thermodynamics. So you don't really need to do more assessment here. You know that this claim is not correct. And this happens often. This is ArchiveX, is an online journal. I don't know that there's been peer review for this particular publication. However, there are peer-reviewed publications that I'm not showing here that have made the same mistake. So. The composition of the water that's used also matters. I've been talking about seawater. It's a particular set of salts at a particular concentration. But seawater is mostly sodium chloride, about 80%. And so this green curve is about like seawater. This is the recovery ratio, the percentage of water that I take as pure water. I was talking about 50% recovery, so I'm about here. The units are a little different. This is kilojoules per kilogram rather than kilowatt hours. But my main point on this is that if I change the salt that is dissolved, if I looked at sodium sulfate instead of sodium chloride, the energy to separate is different. Maybe that's obvious, but it sometimes gets lost in the discussion. The question of what energy is required depends on how much salt and which salts. It's less for groundwater. It's more for water that comes from oil and gas, and it depends on the mixture itself. That has to be remembered. It depends on the concentrations and the composition both. I want to say more about oil and gas waters. It's a very big issue in the U.S., and I noticed coming in here that there's a refinery very nearby. Obviously, there's a lot of oil production in this region, too. So in the U.S., we've seen a great revolution in energy supply as a result of hydraulic fracturing, shale gas and shale oil. In 2014, the United States passed Saudi Arabia as the world's largest producer of oil. So this is a very big thing in the U.S. Our prices for natural gas have plummeted as well. It's very inexpensive now. They're talking about moving certain kinds of basic manufacturing back into the U.S. because energy costs are now low enough to make things like glass and steel competitive where they may not have been before. But one of the major effects of this type of oil production is a lot of water that's produced as wastewater. It comes from the initial fracturing, but it also comes from the ongoing operation of oil extraction as water comes out. In fact, this is common to even conventional oil and gas. You produce a lot of wastewater. And the water that's produced can be far saltier than seawater. So this is a chart showing some dissolved salts. This is standard seawater with a composition of about 35,000 milligrams per kilogram or parts per million. But this is water produced in West Texas in the Permian Basin, a representative sample. And it has a salinity that is roughly 5 times the salinity of seawater. This is one sample that varies from place to place. Some of the samples go well over 200,000 parts per million. So the salinities are much higher. For Nova Scotia, water from fracking there is about twice seawater. If you go to Pennsylvania and the Marcellus Shales, it's again three, four times higher than seawater. And the composition of ions differs as well. Some of these waters have much higher percentages of strontium, perhaps of barium, and some other ions. And these other ions are important for a number of reasons. Some of them form salts that do not stay dissolved very much. They're highly insoluble. So they very easily start to precipitate on equipment and ruin equipment. Some of them, like strontium, are mildly radioactive. And so they pose, in addition, health risks if the concentrations are high. And so you have a different set of challenges with this kind of water than with seawater. The basic calculation I showed you of energy consumption, energy requirement, can be redone for this kind of water. We have full implementations of the Pitzer-Kim model for dissolved electrolytes. And we're able to take the samples we have and compare. So this is the curve for seawater that I showed you before for sodium chloride, recovery ratios here. Energy requirement now in kilowatt hours per cubic meter is here. This is the water produced in oil operations in Nova Scotia. This is Pennsylvania. This is Texas. And you can see that the energy requirement for purifying, the least energy requirement for purifying the Texas water can be up to 8 times higher than that for seawater. So comparing this type of desalination to seawater desalination doesn't mean a lot. You know it's going to take more energy. You know it's going to be more expensive. And in fact, you are also going to have challenges related to the dissolved salts that I mentioned. This chart shows some analysis of the ionic composition of these solutions. This is the saturation index. It's the log of the activity product over the activity at saturation. When the saturation index is zero, that means that stuff no longer stays in solution. It will precipitate. So zero is the important number. And this is the amount of water I've removed from the produced sample. If I'm looking at the water in Nova Scotia, I can take out most of the water, 80% of it, before anything starts to precipitate. And what starts to precipitate is just sodium chloride. It's easy to remove. If I look at the water from Texas, almost immediately I will start to precipitate barite, strontium sulfate, calcium sulfates as well, come out quickly. And so I have to think, for this kind of water, what am I going to do to pre-treat that water to get these things out before it ever gets to my expensive equipment? And so a lot of work is done on pre-treatment here. It's interesting, the calcium sulfate, this is basically gypsum or plaster. If you make wallboard, the white stuff is calcium sulfate. I had the privilege of visiting a volcano yesterday. And down in the basin of this particular volcano, there's a large layer of white sandy material, which I'm pretty sure is mostly composed of these types of salts. You think about it, this is coming from water that's been in the ground a long time. It's come to equilibrium with the ground. The water that comes up in the volcano is a similar origin, and so you expect similar kinds of compositions. I want to talk about thermal processes. I've told you about membrane processes a bit, and I'm showing here a diagram of a representative thermal desalination process called multi-stage flash distillation, MSF for short. This is representative of about 20% of the plants in use worldwide. About half of the installed capacity for seawater is of this technology. And it's mostly found in the Gulf states, the Arabian Gulf states. In this system, seawater, which is relatively cool, is brought into a plant. It's cold. It's sent into a tube bundle where it acts as a coolant for a condensation process, condensing water vapor. It goes through many stages of this, eventually leaving the condensing stages at a temperature of about 70 Celsius. Then steam from an adjacent power plant is used to top heat this water to perhaps 90 or 100 C. And then the hot seawater, the hot brine, is taken through a series of small pressure drops, goes into one chamber after another through maybe 20 to 28 of these stages. In each chamber, the pressure drops by 5 to 10 kPa, small pressure changes. This is done by a weir as the water flows through. But when the pressure drops for the hot water, vapor flashes. And so in each of these stages, you flash a few percent of the water into vapor. And the vapor is then condensed by the process I described before. The water will go through many of these stages. It will eventually be subatmospheric down at this end and will be rejected finally back to the ocean. The terminal stage here is probably at a saturation temperature of about 40 C, typically 38 is the minimum. This process, by the way, was invented by a mechanical engineer. His name was Robert Silver. He was the James Watt Professor of Thermodynamics at Glasgow. I've already told you how widely used this important process has become. Here's a photograph, an aerial of one of these large plants in the Gulf. You have here a power plant, perhaps a Rankine cycle plant, maybe a combined cycle plant. They're burning a fuel, maybe heavy crude. They're trying to de-emphasize using natural gas because they want it as a saleable product. But some of the steam from the turbines is extracted and used for the MSF process, as I described. Each one of these units is an MSF process. These return bends you see are the feed water reversing direction through successive tubing bundles. And so you can see there are a very large number of sequential stages here. A large plant of this type can produce on the order of 500,000 cubic meters of water per day. It is essentially a river of water being produced. A plant of this size produces enough water to supply a city of 2 million people with their fresh water needs. And many cities throughout the Arabian Gulf have plants of this type adjacent. And I've had a chance to see a few of them. They're very impressive. I told you about the thermodynamics of the work-driven process, but I just showed you a thermally driven process. So I want to mention that as well. I have the same control volume, but now instead of work coming in, I have heat at a high temperature. And so essentially I've got a temperature difference and heat transfer through it. This is like a Carnot engine. You know that if you take heat from high to low temperature, you can generate a certain amount of work. And it's straightforward to calculate the least amount of work that would be required if this process were reversible. And so you can run these numbers as shown. The thermodynamic limit, the best you'll do, depending on what this high temperature is in the range of 12 to 14 kilojoules of thermal energy, not work, not electrical energy, thermal energy, per kilogram. It's very important to have in mind that I'm talking about the thermal energy input because, you know, electricity requires thermal energy to be generated, right? That's the exergetic difference between the two of them. And very importantly, you can't compare thermal energy and mechanical energy. You don't add kilowatts of electricity to kilojoules of heat. It's like adding an apple to an orange. It means nothing. So you have to keep those separate as you do this kind of thinking. Plants such as the one I showed you require actually about 20 times this amount of energy from low temperature steam. So there's a much bigger difference between the reversible and the irreversible case here. The reason for that is partly a matter of design. You generate entropy when you transfer heat through a temperature difference irreversibly without taking any work. You always generate entropy. Well, excuse me, you generate entropy when you don't take the work. But in this case, to minimize the amount of entropy you generate, you need to keep the temperature differences small. And to do that, you need very big heat exchange. And that means a lot of copper tubing and a lot of capital cost. And it gets very expensive to design a system that's going to minimize entropy generation. So you don't do that. You design for a lower capital cost to make the cost of water lower. You pay a little more for energy, but you pay a lot less for capital investment. And so the water is cheaper. In other words, these systems are optimized around cost of water and not around energy efficiency. And that's the reason that there's such a big spread. I could ask, if I use this amount of thermal energy at 100 C to generate electricity instead of desalinating, how much electricity could I generate? And the answer is you could generate about 10 kilowatts of electrical energy. Right? That's still a lot more than it took to run the reverse osmosis plant. Right? So it is, by this measure, less efficient than reverse osmosis. It's actually even a little worse, though, because to circulate those rivers of water, you need a lot of pumping energy. And the pumps require electricity. They require about 3 kilowatt hours of electricity per cubic meter. And so these plants are really inefficient by several measures. I want to talk a little bit about the top temperature in these systems as well. The high temperature matters. And so what I've done here is I've plotted the energy required. This is the recovery ratio again. But most important, this is the high temperature. So here's a high temperature of 50, of 75, of 100 C. Here's solar temperature just for reference. And what you can see is that if you don't have 100 degree top temperature, if you only have 50, the energy requirement is much higher because the Carnot efficiency behind the heat input is much less high. And so much more energy is needed. in any of these processes, you're better off when the top temperature is greater. And this is important because people talk about waste heat a lot. Can I use waste heat to desalinate? Can I embed waste heat in my process? Well, the value of that waste heat is very sensitive to the temperature at which it's taken. It has much greater ability to do work if it's at higher temperature. Even small improvements make a big difference in this range of temperatures. So you're much better off going higher. For seawater, you really can't go much beyond this because you have the insoluble salts that I mentioned. And so we tend to get stopped here. But at the same time, solar energy remains an important part of this because there's interest in desalinating with solar power and using either solar thermal or solar electricity to desalinate. In fact, for the photovoltaic-driven process, there's been a lot of research, a lot of things have been developed in this direction. Photovoltaic panels by today have gotten very cheap because of the vast production that's happening in China. And so there are many efforts at a research scale to drive desalination for small systems with photovoltaics. There's also work done to look at whether you can do it with small thermal systems, particularly when you're talking about brackish groundwater desalination. I want to say a few words about this topic again. I mentioned it before. The chart that I'm showing here are numbers from the U.S. Geological Survey. They've been trying to map the salinity of wells over the United States. And the data that they have here represent a very large number of samples, maybe 200,000 measurements that they've made. The little green circles, this is the salinity comparable to Copiapó, the green ones. The red ones are much higher, maybe up to 30% of the salinity of seawater. The way this is plotted, the red circles land on top of the green circles. So it's a little misleading. There's certainly low salinity wells in these areas, but they're just more high salinity wells. You can see there's a lot of groundwater that's very saline. That's the important takeaway. Now, the salinity of groundwater itself varies quite a bit, and it does so in part because of the geology of the aquifer from which the water is taken. You can think of groundwater as being present because the surface layers of rock are broken or crusty or porous, and when it rains, water percolates into the ground. When you're near the surface, there's a lot more percolation happening, a lot more fresh water entering. And so shallow wells tend to be fresher than deeper wells. And for water that's been very deep or underground for a long time, it's had much more time to come to equilibrium with the rock around it. And as a result, it tends to be saltier. So very often, these highly salty wells are also the deeper. What I'm showing here is a similar chart for India. This is from my colleague Amos Winter, who's been interested in water supply in India. And you can see that in many parts of India, the salinity of groundwater is quite high. They use a lot of groundwater for irrigation in India. They grow food. In fact, particularly out here in Gujarat and Rajasthan, a lot of water is being pumped up electrically to provide for agriculture. But this water can be very salty. Most crops cannot tolerate salinity above about 1,000 ppm. There's some that can go higher, but generally there's too much chloride in that water and it starts to kill the plants. And so you really want the salinity to be more in the green range if you're just using it for irrigation. For drinking, you'd really rather prefer it was in this light blue range. Water like this does not taste very good. Next slide. Amos noticed that these regions that have very high salinity also have very high solar irradiance. So when you come out to regions like Gujarat and Rajasthan or down here in the Deccan Plateau, you do have, you know, reasonable amounts of sunshine available to drive desalination. And so what he's been interested in is using a process called electrodialysis. It can be run directly with photovoltaic electricity. And you have an anode, a cathode, an electric field. Water enters a set of membranes here. It's all salty. But some of these membranes are permeable to positive ions or anions, and some of cations, and some of the membranes are permeable to negative ions that flow toward the anode. And the result is that as you proceed, the electric field drives the positive ions here, but they can't pass that membrane. Drives the negative ions here, but they can't pass that membrane. So this stream winds up highly concentrated with salts. These two streams on either side get diluted. You can can desalinate it as much as you want. Instead of making pure water, you could just make 1,000 ppm water and stop there. Next slide. This process has some energetic advantages. It takes less energy than RO when the salinity is reasonably low. And so it's a better choice, perhaps, than RO on an energetic basis. Capital issues, capital cost issues still have to be worked out, but that's Amos's research. Next slide. So the pie chart that I'm showing you here is a distribution of desalination technologies worldwide. We're already producing more than 80 million cubic meters per day of water by desalination, or 80 billion liters per day of drinking water are produced this way. Most of it is, I'm not sure what happened to the words here. Don't worry about it. This says reverse osmosis. It just somehow didn't pop up. Reverse osmosis is 65% of it. The multi-stage flash I mentioned is 22%. Some other thermal processes are another 8%. Click. This total amount of water, there it is, reverse osmosis. Total amount of water production is equivalent to about 6% of the world's domestic water. I want to break that number down carefully. Domestic water means basically what you use in households and residences. It's only about 10% of fresh water consumption worldwide. Agriculture, power production use much more. But it gives you a benchmark. It's equivalent to about 0.8% of total fresh water withdrawal. So this is still a big number. Total fresh water withdrawal per year is about 4,000 cubic kilometers of water, kilometers cubed of water, very big numbers. Next slide. Of this, about 50% of the seawater desalination is from these two processes. The rest is from reverse osmosis. So seawater is not all of the desalination at all. Brackish groundwater is a very large part of it, essentially all reverse osmosis. But the reverse osmosis contribution is growing very fast. And it will displace these thermal technologies over time. These thermal plants are large, high capex plants. It's not that hard to retube them and retrofit and keep going. So they have very long working lives, you know, 30, 40 years is not unusual. And as a result, it's going to be a long time before that goes offline. It's also interesting to notice where the biggest capacities are. I've mentioned the Arabian Gulf a number of times. Of course, they were the early ones to get into this. They're desperately dry area, rapid population growth, plenty of money to build plants, and they moved into desalination a long time ago. The United States is actually third or fourth in terms of capacity. And you don't notice it in the U.S. Because it's a small fraction of a very large water use. But we are there. Spain has been very active. Algeria, China is building a number of plants. Australia has built a number. Israel, there are technology leaders in this area. They will probably be net water exporters. Think about that. To live in a desert and be an exporter of water. A very interesting model. So I've mentioned energy. I want to talk about the things that make these systems inefficient. And here I'm going to get a little technical for a while, a little more technical than I've been. What I'm showing here is a block diagram of a representative single-pass reverse osmosis system. Seawater enters a feed pump. The feed pump sends water to a high-pressure pump where water might leave at 69 bar in this case. It enters the membrane modules, the pressure vessels I showed you, and then say 40% of it leaves as low-pressure fresh water. So there's been a big drop in pressure for the water passing through the membrane, an irreversible drop. But the remaining part of the water, 60%, leaves at still fairly high pressure. The enthalpy of that water flow, the energy, if you like, in that water flow, is recovered through one of several types of pressure recovery devices. This could be something like a turbocharger, where the high pressure water on this side enters a turbine that's shaft coupled to a pump on the other side, and so the turbine drives a pump that pressurizes the water. They're much more sophisticated designs based on rotary devices called pressure exchangers. I'd love to give a lecture on those, but I don't have time today. But look them up. They're really cool for mechanical people. They involve ceramic water bearings and all sorts of neat technology. Anyway, you recover a lot of energy here. This is responsible for an energy efficiency boost of about 30% in the process. The pressurized feed comes back to this side. Click. You can analyze these systems using standard thermodynamic calculations, all the stuff you would have learned in undergraduate thermo, and you can very quickly find out that 54% of the entropy production is in the reverse osmosis module. It's the depressurization of water there that accounts for most of the inefficiency, the entropy creation in the system, and I'll show you why. This is a flow path through the pressure vessel, representative flow path. You have feed water entering at high pressure here, seawater. It flows through these membranes. As water passes through the membrane, the fresh water is collected in the center tube and taken out. You might take away half the water as fresh water. The feed water, as it loses fresh water, becomes saltier and saltier. It eventually leaves over here as a brine. If you've taken half of the water as fresh water, the salinity of the leaving brine is twice as high as the feed coming in. So, if the feed coming in had an osmotic pressure of 30 bar, over here it's going to have an osmotic pressure of 60 bar, about twice as high, which means that you need the hydraulic pressure here to be greater than 60 bar in order that any water will flow through the membranes, which means that the hydraulic pressure here has to be even greater. And so if you make a chart, you'll see entering, leaving, the osmotic pressure rising progressively as you take water out. This is actually slightly curved like this. It shouldn't be a straight line. And then the hydraulic pressure, in order to have high hydraulic pressure here, you make it very high over here, the inlet. So look at what you've done. You've overpressurized this thing dramatically in the early stages, much more pressure than you needed to make water flow. Basic hydraulic design problem, right? If you do the calculations, you find that the entropy generation goes as the square of the difference between hydraulic and osmotic pressure. So you're generating enormous amounts of entropy here. And this is why you're getting so much inefficiency in the membrane module. Now, as a mechanical engineer, you immediately start redesigning this, right? You say, well, I don't need to do it this way. Why don't I start with a pump at a low pressure over here? I only need this much pressure to drive it. Then as the osmotic pressure goes up, I'll have another pump, pressurize again, another pump, pressurize again. Step it up, right? So I'm going to cut the entropy generation for sure. That's very clear. But I'm paying a price for that, right? I just added three more pumps to the system. And these are very large pumps. The plant like this might circulate through those pumps 200,000 cubic meters of water every day at high pressure. And so the capital cost of the plant just went up dramatically with my redesign, right? And that's why you don't design it this way. It's not that it's unknown that you could do that. But the problem is that the cost of water rises. Again, you're into a situation where CapEx starts to exceed gains in OpEx, and you don't want to do that. There is a solution, though, to this, next click, which is to look at a closed circuit process. And so this is a relatively newer technology. This is a startup in the Boston area. And what they're doing is they're using a closed circuit and circulating seawater or brackish groundwater through a pressure vessel. Here are some membranes. Fresh water is taken. As water flows out, they have a variable drive pump that tops it up. But the other thing that happens is that the salinity of this water is going to rise progressively as you run the process. And so you can maintain an osmotic pressure that's just slightly, or hydraulic pressure that's just slightly above the osmotic pressure. And as the osmotic pressure rises, you can raise the hydraulic pressure. So you avoid having the overpressurization that generates all that entropy. And the result is that their design can cut energy usage by about one-third. Particularly good technology for high recovery, brackish desalination. And that's its real sweet spot. So now I want to connect some of these ideas to thermal processes. I talked to about the thermal systems before. I'm going to talk about some evaporative processes in a moment. We need some thought models for this. This is a counterflow heat exchanger. We have hot water entering one side, cold water entering another side. Depending on the capacity rates of the two streams, the hot water temperature might drop this way, the cold water temperature might rise this way. In this particular case, the cold water has a higher capacity rate, m dot times Cp, than the hot water, and so its temperature doesn't change as much. with the result that in this heat exchanger, you've got a higher temperature difference at this end than you have at this end. Now, the entropy generation goes as the essentially as the temperature difference through which the heat is transferred, which means that in this case, you're generating a lot more entropy at this end than at this end. And so the design's not balanced. This is not new information. You know, we know that you can balance the heat exchanger by making the capacity rate ratios equal, in which case the temperature change for each stream is the same. The entropy generation is made uniform. Possible to sit down and calculate, then, the entropy generation in the heat exchanger as a function of this heat capacity rate ratio, cold over hot stream, and as a function of the effectiveness of the heat exchanger and the inlet temperatures. And if you do that, you find that the entropy generation is minimized when the heat capacity rate ratio is 1, which gives you a tool for designing systems that incorporate these heat exchangers to get better performance. And so balanced heat exchangers, so-called regenerators, are already in broad use in the power generation industry because of this characteristic. However, when you do desalination, many common processes will vaporize water. Right? The idea is that when you vaporize water, the salts stay in the liquid phase, and the vapor that's produced is pure. And if you vaporize water into an airstream, then you're raising its humidity. And this is another technology that gets applied for desalination. So here's a schematic drawing of a block drawing of a humidifier. You could think of this as being like a cooling tower. You have water entering here, warm water, maybe sprayed over a packing. Cold, dry air enters the bottom. As it rises, water vaporizes into it. It leaves as warm, humid air. And so you've got a process then where energy is being transferred from the water stream that enters to the air stream that leaves, and with it, water mass. To characterize this, you can't just look at m.cp because the air phase is also absorbing the latent heat of water as the vaporization occurs. So you need to look at the enthalpy ratios. And I'll talk here about a heat capacity rate ratio, which is the enthalpy rate of the cold stream divided by the enthalpy rate, or the maximum enthalpy rate change of the hot stream. And so if you do the analysis of entropy generation for a device like this, you find again that Sgen is minimized when the heat capacity rate ratio is 1. And so it tells you where you should design systems of this sort when you are doing evaporative processes into air. And this becomes very relevant to the design of the next system I'll show you, which is illustrated here. This is the so-called humidification, dehumidification, desalination process. It's a very simple kind of idea. You have saline water, salty water. It's again going through a dehumidifier where it's acting as a coolant in a heat exchanger. It's absorbing the heat of condensation. It's being preheated. You bring it to the top here and add additional heat as needed. You spray it over a packing on this side. Countercurrent to that, you've got air circulating inside or some other gas. Air enters here as cool, dry air. It leaves as warm, moist air. You take the moist air over to the condenser side and condense the pure water. And you can recirculate the water as much as you want to get the recovery that you like. So this is technology that we've been working on for some time. We like it because it's very robust. Very basic unit operations are involved in this. There's no fancy membrane, no fancy fluid, and everything in here I can go out and buy, basically. That is a packing. So it's like a splash packing. You can imagine it as porous PVC sheets. You spray the water over it, the water trickles down, and air flows up through the open space. It could also. In some, if you think by analogy to cooling towers, it is a cooling tower. And some cooling towers have the packing I described. Some have what you described, no packing. So it's a design variable. So the one challenge here is that you have air in the dehumidifier side. And so when you imagine vapor flowing to the cold condenser surface to condense, the water vapor condenses and flows away, but it sweeps air with it. And the air cannot condense. And so air collects at the surface of the dehumidifier. It forms a resistance to vapor diffusion, a resistance to heat transfer, and it lowers the efficiency very much, perhaps 2 orders of magnitude less than if you had pure vapor. So we replaced that idea with a bubble column, a direct contact process, where we have a sparger plate. We bring warm, moist air in through holes in this plate, forms bubbles in a pool of water. The bubble surface is now the condenser surface. No metal condenser surface. You don't have incondensable gas because everything collects in the bubble surface. And as a result, you have a device that's compact, inexpensive, that you can use to do the dehumidification. So we brought this in. The design of the plant is still complicated because the mass flow rate of air and water is coupled between the two devices. I can't just pick a heat capacity rate ratio for one without affecting the design of the other. And so this all has to be done in an integrated way using software. But it's doable. And when we look at these systems, we find that we can vary the heat capacity rate ratio. The performance is maximized for a heat capacity rate ratio of 1 in the dehumidifier. The quantity I'm plotting here is something called gained output ratio. And let me explain what it is. If I'm going to produce m dot amount of fresh water, if I did it just by boiling the water and condensing it, I'd have to provide the latent heat of vaporization. So it'd be m dot HFG. I'd like to use less. And I'd like to do that by recovering the heat of condensation, as I did in the dehumidifier, as they do in the MSF plant. You recover it and reuse it. And so that would allow you to put in less heat than would be required just to boil and condense. And so this ratio measures how much less heat. You want the number to be greater than 1. For this particular device, in a simple realization, gained output ratio is 2.5. Other variations of this can get to 4 to 6 for gained output ratio. But it's a performance metric, gives you some idea how this works. The other important design idea, and I'm really just sort of putting out some of the thermal design concepts that are relevant to this type of a system. In this case, we've got a pool of water at some temperature, and that is what dictates sort of the fixed middle temperature of the process. In the flash evaporation processes, the fixed temperature was the saturation temperature in any one of those flash chambers. And so there's often a temperature that's fixed by a thermodynamic state that you're stuck with. And so in this case, it's the water temperature. So look at what happens. The moist air enters at some high temperature. The best it can do is to cool down to the water temperature. I may have seawater inside this coil getting preheated. It comes in at a low temperature, but it can't get any hotter than the pool temperature. So I didn't get anywhere near the potential. I would have liked to get the seawater up to this temperature, the moist air down to that temperature. I'm stuck because I've just got this one pool. And click again. If I do instead a system that's got several pools, I can go in stages. So I can cool the moist air in one pool. I can then go to a new pool and cool it again, a new pool and cool it again, and do it successively through a series of pools, raising the seawater temperature in opposition. For this system, the efficiency was about 30%, whereas for this system, with just 3 or 4 trays, I'm up to 92%. And so this staging allows me to work around a set thermodynamic state that would otherwise pin the process in a bad way. You wonder what this looks like? Here's a prototype that we built in our lab. We have moist air entering down here, pool 1, pool 2, pool 3, pool 4. The air bubbles through each of these, then goes to the next one, and the next one, and the next one. And so it can rise successively. We have flowing in the opposite direction through these coils, seawater, first time warming, second time warming, third time warming, etc. And so it's straightforward to build these. In fact, the physical realization becomes very much like an air stripper. We've commercialized this technology. A couple of my students started a company which is now working to treat that difficult water I mentioned to you in West Texas. And they have a plant that's running out near Midland, Texas, another one in New Mexico. They're currently working to move into Chile and to China for other operations. So they've done really well. So I want to go back to the question of thermodynamic efficiency and talk a little bit about what we mean by efficiency. What I put up here is the second law, efficiency, which is essentially the least amount of energy I need divided by the energy I actually put in. like any efficiency, like a pump efficiency. The pump efficiency is the enthalpy change I actually got in the water I pumped through the pump, divided by the amount of energy I actually had to put into the pump pump shaft, or maybe the motor windings, depending on how you rate the pump. And so it always takes more energy than the least amount, or the useful amount, because of friction and losses and mixing and other things such as I've described. All the stuff that generates entropy. So we can look at this then by saying, okay, the least work is the least exergy, the least useful work that I can put into the system. What did I actually put in? Well, I put in a mixture quite often. I told you about the reverse osmosis systems. I only put in work, right, electrical work. For the MSS system, I put in heat at some temperature, and I put in the work to drive those rivers of water through all the tubing. So I had a mixed input. So I have to think about both of those when I think about the efficiency of total energy use. So we look at this number. And if you go and collect data from literature and other sources, published sources, you can make this chart. My student Emily Tao did this. This is the salinity of water running from brackish water conditions up to seawater conditions, which would be here, and out toward conditions that are more like that very difficult water from oil and gas production. And this is the performance, the efficiency I mentioned for various plants. So starting here, seawater reverse osmosis. These are some representative plants. There's a plant in Tampa Bay, which is an old plant. Here's a plant in Hadera in Israel. Here's a plant in Algeria. And this is what we're calculating as the efficiency of those systems based on their numbers. It's around 30-35% typically. So not bad, clearly could be better if there were ways to do it cost effectively. If we look at the brackish groundwater plants, like the one in Copiapó, you see that the efficiencies are lower. There's not an a priori reason for that. You could make them more efficient. But it goes back to what I've been saying about cost of water. For the brackish plants to get good energy efficiency, you'd need fairly large areas of membrane and pressure vessels, and those are expensive. And so instead of investing capital and having a lot of pressure vessels and membranes, they instead run the pump at a higher pressure, push more water through the membranes, raise the flux, and have a smaller, less expensive system that consumes more energy. Cost of water is effectively lower, but it's not being designed for energy efficiency. The electrodialysis processes I mentioned are in this range. And then the thermal plants I mentioned, are more in the range of, say, 5 to 10% overall efficiency. Not really so good. And in terms of the energy that goes in, you know, not so good. I want to break that down a little bit, because I think it's an important question. People talk about desalinating with waste heat. And, you know, the idea is that the power plant is just sitting here and it has steam to give you. Power plants are designed for very specific bottom end conditions. You design a turbine in order to have a particular low temperature, particular mass flow rate. You don't walk up to a power plant and start pulling steam out of an existing turbine without potentially costing millions of dollars in, you know, turbine redesign costs. So these have to be designed together. And when you design a plant like this, you'll have a power plant, and you're going to take either heat or work from the power plant to drive a desalination system. Could be a reverse osmosis system that runs only on electricity. It could be an MSF system that uses heat and electricity. But in order to make this run, you're going to have to put some additional heat into the power plant to have the waste heat available to take out. For given electricity production, you need a certain amount of energy. If you're now going to produce water too, more energy is needed. And so there's an additional amount of heat that's put in here. It essentially has an exergetic value that goes with it, depending on its temperature. That's the addition to energy input that you have to make in order to get water output. So if we go through the plant and compute its efficiency, you can get numbers of this sort. Click one more time. I'm going to assume that I've got a power plant here that has, it says, a combined cycle plant with 67% efficiency, state-of-the-art thermal power plant. And for the seawater reverse osmosis plants, when you do the computations, you find that it's 10 to 20% efficiency based on primary energy. My previous calculation was based on electricity I already had in my hand. So this is based on actually going back to whatever fuel I'm burning. If I compare instead to MED or MSF, if I include the pump work, you're looking at efficiencies of a few percent. And so, exergetically, in terms of what you could have done with the energy you had, you're certainly going to be better off with the membrane processes under today's design conditions. So the last thing I want to talk about are alternative ways to get water. I've talked a lot about desalination. I want to contextualize this a little bit. And so I want to talk about California for a minute. As you probably know, they've been having a pretty bad drought for the last 4 or 5 years, not much rainfall. With the result, there's really no snowpack in the Sierra Nevada, and not much water available for their aqueduct systems and cities. If you think about the state of California, 80% of its renewable water is coming up here in Northern California. If you know California, if you know Southern California, maybe you've been to Los Angeles, maybe you've been to UCLA, and there's a big street that runs south of it called Wilshire Boulevard. Runs the entire length of Los Angeles, actually. It's more or less here. 50% of California's population of almost 40 million people, 50% of that population is south of Wilshire Boulevard. So the water demand in California is predominantly down here. The water in California is predominantly up here. They have a real problem in that regard. If you were going to design California, you might have put the people someplace else. But in any case, the current solution involves aqueducts that move water, a large amount of water, about 28% of San Diego's supply, is coming from the Sacramento area. About half of their water supply is coming from the Colorado River. It's taken out of the river. And you know, there are a couple of things to say about this. The first is the environmental impact of those water withdrawals. Constant battle in California about who gets the water from the Delta up here. Colorado River, I'm sorry to say, very rarely flows to the Gulf of California. In fact, quite often where it crosses the southern part of the border with Mexico, there's no water in the river. So it's not a good arrangement. But then you look also at the energy consumption. The aqueduct that takes water from Northern California to Southern California consumes 2.6 kilowatt hours of electricity per cubic meter, which is about the same as what I told you was the number for reverse osmosis, which means that you could use reverse osmosis in Southern California and eliminate the aqueduct, leave the water where it is, do less damage up there. And so there's some real questions to be asked about this model of water supply. And the other point about this model of water supply is that when there's no water in Northern California, there's of course no water to put in the aqueduct, whereas a reverse osmosis plant down here would keep on running if there were a drought or not. So in San Diego, they've been looking at this carefully. And San Diego County has recently opened the first seawater reverse osmosis plant in the West, the first large one in the Western Hemisphere, the largest one, I should say, in the Western Hemisphere. It is 200,000 cubic meter per day of freshwater production. It just went online this fall. These are some photographs of it. And its energy requirement for the RO system alone is about 2.7 kilowatt hours. Of course, there are more things that happen in a reverse osmosis plant. You've got to pump the water in. You've got to pre-treat it. You've got to pump it out. If you put all those costs in, it's about 3.6 kilowatt hours. Cost of water here is about $1.65 per cubic meter. That's the sale price of it. It's very important to know that the price of water from reverse osmosis depends on many variables that are not just technology variables. About half of the cost of water here is the cost of loans and investment, the financing of the plant. So how it's financed makes a big difference. Some of the big plants that have had government subsidy and investment are producing water for half this much money. And some of the plants with bad financial models cost a lot more. Just briefly, solar desalination of seawater, small-scale systems, so distributed systems, depending on the efficiency of the plant, this would be like a GOR of about 2. This is a gained output ratio, or GOR of 4. This is 8. Best available thermal systems are in this range today for desalination. This is the energy cost of water in euros per cubic meter, just the energy. And you can see that for the sort of state-of-the-art plants, the energy cost for thermal seawater desalination remains about 3 euros a cubic meter. It's not cheap. But in some cases, it's competitive with PVRO for that purpose, for seawater. But there's still work to do on the pricing, I think, is the conclusion. So to put these numbers sort of into context then, to kind of start to wrap this up, This is a chart showing energy consumption in various things we do with water, our water cycle. Conveying water from point to point, treating water, wastewater treatment, end use. Heating water is one of the most energy intensive things we can do with it. Saving hot water saves a lot of energy. It's very important to think about that. But look at this. Pumping water up from the ground, 0.6 kilowatt hours per cubic meter for a 120 meter lift. Pumping it over grade 100 kilometers, about 0.4 cubic kilowatt hours per cubic meter. These are those long aqueducts I mentioned. Primary treatment, if the water is reasonably clean, doesn't take much energy. Desalination, brackish water, might be 1 kilowatt hour per cubic meter. Seawater RO, say 2 to 3. The flash plants are up here in equivalent energy. You could click again. But when we look at wastewater, secondary treatment of wastewater, just the biological treatment. You've seen the tanks of gravel with the spinning arm over them, maybe, that process. That requires about 0.4 kilowatt hours a cubic meter. But if you treat it just a little bit more, you can make that water so clean you could drink it. You can actually take wastewater back to the same quality or better that you started with. And it takes less energy. It takes less energy than seawater RO, takes less energy than these long aqueducts. So it has to be considered seriously. And in fact, the city of Singapore has taken it quite far. They are currently using a lot of recycled water. The energy requirement for their process is 0.7 kilowatt hours per cubic meter. Very efficient relative to some of the things I've mentioned. They're meeting about 30% of their demand in the city now. They're scaling this up to 50%. It's mostly non-potable. They're sending the water to their factories and fabs for industrial use. They don't actually call it wastewater in Singapore. They call it used water. How you describe it affects how you think about it. The water's only been used. And when you're done with it, it's called new water. And social acceptance is very important to this process because they do put some of it in their potable system. And they're working to scale that up. But this technology is also being used at a number of points in the U.S. There's several places in Texas that put it online this year in response to drought. And in particular, San Diego County is building a large plant to do exactly this. The process has been used in Orange County, California, for quite a while. They are taking their wastewater and sending it through reverse osmosis. They don't put it directly into the drinking water system. They inject it into the aquifer near the ocean to hold back saltwater intrusion into the aquifer, and then they pump fresh water from the aquifer. So they're sort of pretending that the water that's in the ground has nothing to do with the water they sent into it. Nobody thinks of them as being linked. But this is the process they're using, and they have used for quite a long time. And they've won many awards for the quality of their work here. Finally, there's continuing work on novel technologies for recycling water from wastewater. Anybody recognize him? Famous software investor, entrepreneur. But this is a process that he's been funding. You can read what it says. So they are converting waste, human waste, back into water through systems like this. Processes are being done. In the end, water is water. And the question of what's in water is what's important. We know enough about chemistry. We know enough about membranes, filtration, and separation to purify the water as much as we want. So we do have a number of options in that regard. I want to acknowledge, in particular, all the people who do all the work, not him, but everybody else here. He's just the mouthpiece. Without them, none of this good stuff would happen. So thank you.
So those were the slaves and the slave driver.
I guess so.
Estamos haciendo esa broma de los estudiantes de posgrado son los esclavos y los profesores son los tratadores de esclavos y son los que van a dar las conferencias. Okay, we have had here today another angle that, you know, when we talk about renewable energy, we don't really see. But, you know, one of the problems of the air is the water. Of course, there is the energy, there is the population. But, you know, John is really touching upon a very important subject. And Mexico, you know, that there are parts of Mexico that we really need to take care of the water. We are not getting the same cycles as before. I can tell you that when I was a kid in Salamanca, the rain started in May and say goodbye in September. On these days, it's a mess. So that's happening here. I don't know, in Boston, you know.
Well, the weather's crazy.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's been crazier than before.
Yes, absolutely.
There you go. Yeah. So everybody's feeling the impact of having huge cars, you know, more muscle, more power, because there is an effect on that. Okay? So with that thought, I would like to open the floor for questions. Any questions from the audience? Remember, you can ask the question in Spanish if you want to, or you can try your English. Any questions? Yes. And remember, identify yourself so we know that he's from National Polytechnic.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Efrain Moreles. I am studying a doctorate in bioclimatic architecture. And my question is, if the irrigation techniques for agriculture was improved, how much the demand for desalination will reduce? Because in Mexico, there is a big effort for the irrigation techniques. And that's the question.
Okay, so there are two parts to answering that question. One is improvement of irrigation techniques. There's a lot of work being done in this direction, particularly drip irrigation is of great interest to people because it's very water efficient. Traditional flood irrigation, where you flood an entire field, allows a lot of water to run off. It allows a lot of water to evaporate or simply to wet ground where there are no plant roots. What you want is to have the water at the roots of the plant itself. Drip irrigation allows you to do that better. Key challenges in drip irrigation include lowering the pump pressure required to actuate the drip irrigators. Traditional irrigators are a diaphragm over a little aperture. The diaphragm opens at a pressure of about 1 bar. And if you can reduce that pressure, then you can reduce the energy that's needed. One of my colleagues at MIT, Amos Winter, has been working hard on that. He's cut it by 30%. So there's a lot that can be done to make water usage in irrigation better. Some care has to be taken to avoid causing the soil to retain too much salinity as you do this, because the soil relies on water percolating to flush salts through. And when you cut irrigation water, there is some risk that if the water that you're irrigating with has salts, they'll begin to accumulate, and that can produce toxicity for the plants. So there's a balance to be struck. But in terms of desalination for irrigation, there's several things to say. Seawater desalination is too expensive for the needs of farmers in most cases. The water prices I showed you are vastly higher than what a farmer might typically pay for water. In fact, oftentimes water for farming is free, and people have a hard time seeing how they should put a price onto it. For the brackish groundwater, there is an opportunity if it can be done cost effectively, because you're starting with a lower salinity. You know the energy requirements are less. And so there's a possibility that the cost of water could be less, particularly if you're in areas where cost of water is already high. So there are a number of people who've been looking at ways to purify that water. There's also been some research done, this is in California, my colleague Yoram Cohen at UCLA has been looking at recovering some of the runoff from irrigation and purifying it so it could be used to irrigate again effectively. Sometimes the runoff can be more salty, also contains a lot of silts and other things. He's been looking at mobile units that can be used for that purpose. But the bottom line challenge for desalination and irrigation is cost, and whether you can do it cheaply enough to match the price points that farmers expect. If you can couple desalinated water with improvement in water efficiency so the total volume of water used is reduced, then you have another lever on the cost that may be helpful.
I had to cut here the time because we want to get ready for the panel. And I will invite you all to be participants in the panel in the sense that we are going to be talking some different inputs from all the speakers, but then we want you to intervene. By now, you are graduate students. You can have already your own idea about renewables, but that's what is going to be discussed. So you'll be really invited to be part of the discussion. So let's give you a round of applause. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias. So let's take a 5 minute break to get ready for the panel, all right? And if there are any questions, I still invite you, get in contact with them, talk to them, okay? Back in 5 minutes. People from Irapuato, la gente de Irapuato, vamos a prepararnos para el panel. Entonces, estamos listos en 5 minutos para comenzar el panel.